So the classic problem, often referred to as a mountain climber problem, uses the intermediate value theorem to show that if you go up the side of a mountain, say at starting at 8 a.m., and you get to the top at a campsite somewhere, and then the next day on Sunday morning, if you come down at 8 a.m. from that location, actually you'll find that on some point on the way down, it's guaranteed that you're going to pass the same place at exactly the same time. And we're going to demonstrate using the intermediate value theorem as to why that's true, okay? So again, let me see if I could just draw a little mountain here. We have a mountain climber climbing up the mountain, starting at 8 a.m. and getting to a particular location. And then the next day, Sunday, starting at 8 a.m., headed down. What we're saying is that there's going to be one location at least where that mountain climber will pass that location at the same exact time of day, okay? So we're going to use a little TY axis here. So I'm going to call this the T axis for the time of day. And we're going to call this the Y axis to represent how high up the mountain we might be. And since we all have this reference here at 8 o'clock, we'll call the origin, the time index, 8 a.m. Okay, we'll call that 8 o'clock. But we could also generalize as we go along. We could call that time index T sub 1. And let's go up, let's see if we could go up at 5 minute increments. So this would be 8:05, this would be 8:10, this would be 8:15, and this would be 8:20. So again, we'll put this location at 8:20 in the morning, so we'll get some scale. And we're going to introduce two functions in this particular case, right? Let's look at the mountain climber starting at 8 a.m., climbing up the mountain, and we know it takes 20 minutes to get to the top where this campsite is, so we'll say, okay, there you go. There's the level of the top where he's going to, and we'll call that level capital letter H, the height where the campsite is. And of course, that happens at 8:20, he gets to the top. We're going to call this function, I don't know, you could call it anything you want. We'll say y equals g of t for going to the top, something like that, okay? Now, the next morning at 8 a.m., so if we could superimpose this next function on the same graph grid, the next morning at 8 a.m., the person is starting from that location H, that height, and headed down. So that graph, let me choose a different color, we'll call that blue. It's gonna start here, and it's gonna head down, and it's gonna take only 10 minutes. So we have, this is 8 o'clock in the morning, I'm going up by 5 minute increments, this is 8:05, this would be 8:10, 8:15, 8:20. So, we know it's gonna, this person's gonna head down and get to the bottom at 8:10 in the morning. Now you could tell just from this diagram, because of continuity, which is part of the hypothesis of the intermediate value theorem, you could literally see that it's going to intersect at at least one location. But notice the beauty of this. It's not just the same location or the height, right? The Y value along the mountain. It's also occurring at exactly the same time, right? It looks like it landed exactly at 8:05, but it doesn't have to be. It depends on how you draw the continuous function representing going downhill. And we might as well name that function too. We'll call the blue function y equals h for headed downhill, right? H of t, headed down. Okay, now we want to show that there's definitely going to be this location at the same time coming up or down the mountain. How do we show that using the intermediate value theorem? So maybe I need a little bit more real estate here. I'm obliterating the mountain. Oh well. Okay, but you get the idea. Okay. So let's choose a different color and let's see if we could do some neat tricks with these functions. Oftentimes with the intermediate value theorem, simply creating another function which subtracts the given functions you're dealing with does the trick. And it shows the sign change that you're looking for. So let's call the function f of t. Let's call that the difference between the function g and the function h. Right? So if I look at this, let me label this a little bit better. Okay? We'll call these locations, right? We'll call it time index 2, time index 3, right? We could go on and on. But it looks like the time index 3, which we said was 8:10 in the morning, is a nice, as far as we really need to go here. So let's see what would happen. We're going to say f of t sub 1. F of t sub 1 would mean, okay, the g function, g of t sub 1 going up the hill, minus the h of t sub 1 headed down the hill. Now, we could tell from the picture what that would be, right? F of t sub 1, therefore, would equal, well, going up the hill, g of t sub 1, when we're going up, we're at the bottom of the hill, the bottom of the mountain. So that would have to be 0. Minus, the next day, Sunday morning, at time index 1, right, at 8 o'clock in the morning, we're already starting at the top of the hill. So h of t sub 1 is clearly equal to the height of the campsite. So we know that f of t sub 1 is equal to negative h, and negative h has to be a negative number since height is positive. Right? So that's our first little iteration of analysis. Let's draw a little line here. And let's now look at f of t sub 3. Now at t sub 3, we'll notice that the g function is at this level, say right here. And we could call that a different height if you want. We'll call it little h sub 1 because that height is lower than big H, okay? And maybe if the subscripts are annoying you, we don't have to really deal with the subscript. We'll just call it little h, okay? So f of t sub 3, we can say would equal g of t sub 3 minus h of t sub 3. Now, looking at this picture, right? F of t sub 3 would equal, now g of t sub 3, we already said, is some value h, right, little h, minus h of t sub 3, looking at this picture, that's the blue function, right, headed down the hill. When you're at t sub 3, headed down the hill, h of t sub 3, we're back down to 0. So the difference is h, and h is greater than 0 since it's a positive value on this y-axis. Well, now we can apply the intermediate value theorem. We have just showed that we have this function f, little f of t, which goes from negative value, right, negative h, to a positive value, positive h. So by the intermediate value theorem, we're guaranteed, let's use some symbols here to save some space, that there exists, let's say, a c value, which is an element of the interval from 0 to t sub 3. Oops. 0 to t sub 3, if you want to keep it closed. Such that f of c would equal, of course, g of c minus h of c. I'm running out of space. Ugh, hate when that happens. Let me see if I could draw it a little smaller for you. Yeah, real estate is at a premium when you're using electronic boards. Happens. Let's see. Element of the interval from 0 to t sub 3, such that f of c, which equals g of c minus h of c equals zero. Equals zero. How do I know it has to equal zero? Because the function f of t is continuous. It took on a negative value at the left endpoint. You could call t sub 1. And it went to a positive value h at t sub 3. In fact, looking at my interval, I looked at it as a zero time index, but to keep within the generalization that we made, let me just fix that. We should really call that, to be consistent, we'll call it t sub 1. That's better. So since we showed on the interval from t sub 1 to t sub 3 that this function f went from something negative to something positive, I'm guaranteed that it has to be equal to 0 at some value c within this interval. But what's another way of saying that g of c minus h of c equals 0? Well, just move things around a bit. That's the same thing as saying g of c equals h of c. That means this at the same time value of c, you're going to be at the same height. You're going to be at the same location on the mountain. Right? Whatever g of c is will be what h of c is at the same particular time. And it looks like the time I nailed was, depending upon how you draw this, right? The time I nailed it was 8:05, it seems. But it doesn't have to be. Depends on the actual continuous functions of the person going up or down the hill. But the point is, we have proved analytically, as well as with a picture, that that has to happen. So it's not a coincidence that at the same time, he was on the same location of the mountain. And it's all a consequence of the intermediate value theorem.